All right, so we're going to get started. Thank you all for being here. Before we get started, I want to open it up for public comment. I know the two of you said you had some public comment. If you'd like to just briefly express that.
Actually, I would, but part of my public comment is potentially related to what the BOE might have to say.
All right.
And so if it would be possible, could I do public comment after Brent does
his
hearing?
Same hearing, yeah, I kind of want to hear first.
Sounds good. Okay, well then let's get started, unless there's any other public comment?
No.
All right, so would you like to introduce us and get us started?
Certainly. So as I think everyone in this room knows, council has been working since this spring to craft modifications to the current language of the charter with regard to the filling of council vacancies. On Monday, the 23rd, following some discussion on the 16th of August, I distributed to council a draft charter provision that was modeled on Toledo's charter provision on filling council vacancies that calls for, in the first instance, council to fill a vacancy within 30 days. And in Toledo, then it says, if they don't do that, then the mayor will do it, shall do it, and then kicks it to the next election occurring more than 120 days after that. And I think the language there, I don't have it in front of me, is a general election. So because council had expressed concerns about, there was certainly a desire to try to have voters involved at the earliest possible time in choosing their legislative representatives, but also a desire to see vacancies filled more quickly. We followed the Toledo example, provided for an election to be held at the next regular municipal primary or general election occurring more than 120 days after the date of the vacancy. And then we provided for petitions to be filed 60 days prior, sorry, it was 90 days on Monday, and petitions to be filed 60 days in advance of the election. So that seemed to be generally acceptable to council in terms of meeting council's previously articulated goals, having the voters involved at an early point, but also having certainty as to the filling of the vacancy. And so this meeting was scheduled then to provide an opportunity for some additional discussion and kind of chewing on the language prior to Monday's council meeting. The deadline for adopting an ordinance, putting a charter amendment on the ballot in November is next Friday, September 3rd. So after Monday then, in the course of having a number of conversations with the Board of Elections and Brent, and again, I thank them for all their help this week, I sent over the draft language and we got back some helpful feedback. One issue that came up was, you know, can a municipality really have municipal elections in an even numbered year, given the language of the Ohio Constitution? The answer is yes, you can, if it's to fill a vacancy. And so because council wants to see these, or would like the voters to consider adopting language that would have people elected at the earliest time possible to fill a vacancy, we left that in there. And then the next issue that was raised was something that we were trying to figure out, which was costs of special elections. So we had provided for the election to occur at the next, within the time period or after the time period, regular general or primary election. And the BOE was good enough to explain that the primary elections, being partisan in nature, would result in a situation where Cleveland Heights' nonpartisan election would be treated as a completely separate, freestanding special election, and therefore would be charged out across the number of precincts. And at the present time, it looks like that cost would be about $112,000. And Brent Lawler can speak to that a little bit more. So, that's for council's, for this committee's consideration. In the current draft of the language that I most recently distributed, I took out reference to primary elections on the basis of previously expressed concerns about costs. And then the only other change made there was to change the time period so that the current draft now refers to the next regular or general election occurring more than 120 days after the vacancy arises, with petitions to be filed 90 days prior to the election. And the reason for that is most importantly, because the statutory deadline for filing protests to petitions that have been filed is 74 days prior to the election. So in this current special election that council's just wrestled with and adopted and authorized on, what day is today? Is that Wednesday?
Yeah.
You know, there are no protests possible. But the BOE's position, and I think it's a sensible position, is that if we can provide for protests, the timetable should be set up in such a fashion that that could occur. And so that's in the current draft that's before you now, and those are the only changes from Monday.
Okay, I have a really quick question for you about this primary special election concern. There will be, every 4 years, a primary election in Cleveland Heights that is nonpartisan. Is it possible to include those as an option?
Why do you say that?
The mayoral primaries.
There may be.
There may be.
If there is, if there are more than two candidates, okay.
And the other thing that I think that's an excellent point. The other thing is, I tried to wrestle with that the other day. Was it occurred to me that that's only moving your costs forward by maybe 7 weeks.
Okay.
So it's not that it couldn't be done at that time,
but it's less of a concern.
Okay. I mean, I would think so. Yeah.
Do you have any questions or thoughts?
No, I don't. I'm sad. I think I'm satisfied with the proposal.
Can we discuss the cost of the special election? What goes into that?
So here, we are required now by the Secretary of State's office to, for every August election, because in the August election you have to, you have to pay a portion of upfront. And then with so many days after the election, you have to literally bring us a check down for the remainder of it, because there was too many counties and too many municipalities in the state that were not paying it and had no property taxes to take from.
Mm-hmm.
So I just threw Cleveland Heights into this, and that's probably what you, pretty close to what you will be charged for your primary in September this year. Postage goes up this weekend. Printing of the ballot for the contract has gone up. So we don't think that the pricing that you see here is going to be any cheaper.
Right.
It'll probably go up. But that is the estimate that we use for, Widmere, we use it for Mayfield Village. We've had those two special elections this year.
Okay. All right.
That's because the entity calling for the special election has to bear all the costs of that election.
Yes. One more question is about the 30 days and the 10 days. Given council's practice over the last, since I was appointed, I suppose, we didn't do it that way when I was appointed. When Councilman Unger was appointed, I believe we went through the League of Women Voters interviews during that one, I believe. Am I remembering that right, Susanna?
Mm-hmm.
The time frame that people are comfortable with on council for continuing that particular practice, which is not necessarily something we will do or necessarily even need to do. Generally, people have said that it takes longer than 30 days to go through that more open, transparent process. I know with technology and the technology that we've grown used to through Zoom and allowing people to use their webcams to submit videos and that kind of thing, we might be able to avoid actually setting up an in-person interview where somebody's filmed and instead do it a different way. But are we talking about getting rid of that process then by adding this 30 days instead of making it 45 or 60 as some of our colleagues have seemed to prefer?
I think that's a question for council. That process, of course, is not reflected in the current charter provision or anywhere else in Cleveland Heights' charter or ordinances, and has been rather a custom and a practice that's been developed over time for lots of good policy reasons. It's, I think, in my from my perspective, it's a little unusual among cities generally to do that, but if council feels that it's been useful and that even with a potentially quicker election under this structure, it's still something that they'd like to do, then I would agree that 30 days is a pretty short period of time, because you're gonna have an application period, I don't know, 14 days or something, and so then at that point you're looking at 16 days left out of that 30 for all of that to occur and for council to review the interviews and to make its decision.
Okay. Now, second question, we could potentially also put more requirements or duties on council, things like, or even automatic, things that are automatic as the result of a vacancy, like releasing an application within X number of days in order to make sure, you know, that kind of thing. And maybe allowing council to provide by ordinance for the, I don't know, the content of that application. So it can be automatically released without having to negotiate among council members when a vacancy comes up. And it can just simply be released and we don't have to wait. For instance, when former Councilwoman Yazanow resigned, it was a surprise to everyone. I certainly didn't know until she said the words in the meeting that it was going to happen. As a result, we had absolutely no chance whatsoever to prepare for that. And then it took quite a long time, certainly longer than I would prefer, to release an application for people to, you know, apply for the vacancy. And if we can avoid that, I think it's possible that we should at least think about that. I don't know what kind of language that would require.
So, I'm sorry.
And that's all.
Those are all, I think those thoughts are apt.
Or is this something that we could just do by ordinance?
I was just gonna say, I think my concern would be not putting too much here in something that the voters have to approve. And if you want to change, the voters have to change, just because of the difficulty of that process and the timing involved.
Thanks.
But I do think it would be not at all a bad idea for council to think through in advance of an actual vacancy what they think that process ought to be. And to that could certainly be embodied in an ordinance.
Thank you for working that out with me in this moment, sort of brainstorming, I guess. All right, let's see. So what would, if council decides that 30 days is not enough to perform the thorough, transparent application period, what would that do to the timeline for these things?
I'm not certain that it would require, I mean, depending upon what you adjusted the number to, I'm not sure that it would require, I'm not sure that 45 days, for example, would require a change in the 120 and 90.
Okay.
Now, you might have some folks who would be interested in applying who would be saying to themselves, well, geez, I got to go pull petitions at the same time. You know, it could be somewhat awkward depending upon when the vacancy develops. But if it's 45 days, I don't think that causes a problem here. And if you're close to just 120 days prior to the election, you know, that's where the 30 days comes in handy, because you're going to have somebody elected in 4 months.
Right.
And you may, at that point, leaving it up to council to decide if they want to involve the League of Women Voters, I think is something that council could consider.
Is there any? Okay. I'm wondering if there's any value to considering if an election is within a certain timeframe from the vacancy, that there is no appointment. That we just wait till the election. People, you know, get signatures in a specific window before an election.
Right. I think you could do that. I guess I'm trying to think about a situation in which you have multiple vacancies potentially and have important issues coming up where you may have a division on council that might make reaching a decision difficult. Mm-hmm. That's not something that would happen a lot, but
it's possible.
There are situations in which having a full complement of council people could make the difference. Yeah.
All right. So, and in the last line, we're the obviously the 150 and the 180. We need to. Fix that, right?
You're looking at which version, sorry.
Oh, sorry, it just says, such petition shall not be signed.
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you.
Okay.
I see it. It's just a typo.
Yeah, no, I know.
But yes.
I feel like this is going to be a quick work session, but I would like to hear, do you have some words that you'd like to...
Is Brent going to talk?
I think that would be great to hear from him from my perspective.
Yeah, yeah.
I did want to raise one issue that Brent raised with me today, which was potentially getting rid of the reference to regular municipal elections, since we provided in here based on Toledo that if the vacancy arises in a year at which that office would normally be filled, which would be a regular municipal election, then you don't have any other sooner election. It's maybe not an issue anyway, but using the term general election, which is defined in the ORC as the election that happens on that prescribed date every November, mm-hmm. we think would capture every November election so that it's just simpler and may be easier for people to follow.
So at the next general election occurring.
Right.
Yeah, because it just eliminates the additional words and additional discussion. The only other concern that I brought up this morning was the second paragraph, further vacancy on council not occurring in the year that the election for that office is scheduled. If they resign prior to, we'll use this as a year, if they resigned in 2020, to me that doesn't apply because that's someone's gonna look at it and say, well, it's not occurring in the year of the election for that office. Well, mm-hmm. So we were thinking perhaps maybe using the 150, is it 150 days? Is that the
120?
120?
Yeah.
Using the 120 days.
But if a vacancy arose in 2020, which would not be a year in which anyone would normally be elected, then you'd be looking to see if it was 120 days prior to the November
right.
election of 2020, right?
Right.
Right.
And so the idea basically is that if it was within 120 days after the date, then we'd have to wait until the next November
yeah.
in order to fill it by election.
Yeah.
It seemed clear to me last night as I was dreaming about calendars that you could mark up on a calendar those areas where these different things overlap. But it should be, under this structure, it should be not possible for someone to be serving as an appointed council person for more than about 16 months,
okay.
something like that.
Yeah, I think that's so.
That would be the worst case.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's like, you know, 119 days or 120 days.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. And so are we not placing any specific requirements for petitioning in this?
It does not. And so that's a good point, because we could point back to the otherwise applicable signature requirements, because this is the same period of time. And so I think, in the situation that unfolded this week, people have a very short period of time. So we were able to look at state law, and our deadlines didn't work anyway. Here, those deadlines should work.
And then obviously...
Sorry, it's not the deadline. Yeah, the signature requirements.
Yeah. One last issue. There's always the, what if the mayor doesn't fill it?
So most of the, if council doesn't, then the mayor does, provisions don't have a deadline on the mayor.
Right.
Because, you know, times seem to be interesting these days. I put a time requirement there.
Okay.
It's not required, but what this would do, I think, is to provide a taxpayer with the ability to bring a mandamus action and require that the mayor fill it.
Okay.
And in both of those timetables should make it unlikely that it gets through both without an appointment. Council typically is going to want, unless they want to just stand back from a selection, they're typically going to want to make that and not cede that authority to the mayor. The mayor, similarly, is going to want to go ahead and appoint somebody,
yeah.
If they can.
Okay, well, I can say this just for my own personal preference. I don't generally like the idea of one person appointing, but I know that the alternative is likely not going to be something that we can get through this council. So I think I may be willing to compromise on that, even though I don't like the idea of a mayor making that appointment. But I don't know, what are your thoughts on that?
I think what happened this year was unprecedented for Cleveland Heights. We would have to be very unlucky for that to occur a second time. I think the likelihood of this mayoral hammer clause actually being used is slim, but watch it happen next year after saying that. We're going to need a seventh councilman. So, you know, this seems to me to be the best option. If council fails to do it, then I would prefer to leave it up to the mayor as opposed to the president of city council, as some have suggested.
Yeah.
And I think that further will be an incentive to council to compromise. And as you said before, I think that the president of council may deadlock it simply to be able to have the ability to put the person in they want.
Yeah. Okay. And I think that, let me think, so that's one, two, based on what I've heard, and I'm not holding anybody to it, that's at least three that are on board with that idea, if I'm willing to compromise. I don't remember where Mike stands on it, but we can figure that out later. Okay.
Yeah. But are we pretty confident now that this proposal doesn't conflict with any other provisions in the charter? I mean, I'm concerned we're sort of rushing this process along. And I don't want to end up with unintended consequences again.
Right. I would say two things. One, that if we specify the number of signatures simply by reference to the to Article 7, that should address that issue. And otherwise, other than, you know, one signature per candidate, blah, blah, blah. Those things could be pointed to as well, but they wouldn't be in conflict with those provisions under, you know, in any event.
And then when do we need to pass this to get it on the ballot?
Before next Friday,
because I think we do need to give the public an opportunity to weigh in and comment. Is there an appetite for having another special meeting, which...
Well, I have that appetite, but you will have to take it up with the person that decides such things.
How many votes do you need to pass it? Charter?
Five.
Supermajority?
You need five of the six current members.
Do we have an idea about the schedule of our members and whether or not they will be in the jurisdiction when we could potentially be having special meetings.
Well, Wednesday the 1st is a planning and development meeting.
Okay.
At 6 o'clock.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe Thursday the 2nd would be.
We don't know at the moment.
Doable.
Sort of like what everyone's availability is, but we could reach out and develop that information. At least I'm not aware that we have that collected presently.
Are both of you available on the 2nd?
Huh. I'm always available.
Me too.
Yes, I am.
Let me get back to you.
Okay, thank you. I believe Davida is available when I spoke with her about when she'd be in this week coming up. But I can quickly find out.
Is there a reason there can't be public comment on Monday?
Well, thank you for asking.
Yes.
There is only one reason, and that would be that the it would be the desire of the person who sets the agenda whether or not there's public comment. There is no public comment required at our special meeting.
That's correct.
Or committee meetings.
Okay, gotcha.
That's correct. We took that off.
But it is something that is permissible. So we can include public comment if we so choose, if five members of council or if the council president chooses. Is it five? Is that the?
Five.
To change the agenda.
Yeah.
And to take public comments online, do we also need council presidents?
No, we can accept, or actually the administration has no need for council approval to accept comments from the public and provide them to us.
Is that something that we could do, is post this legislation and put some notice on our social media?
And what's your deadline?
Mm-hmm. Between now and Monday, that seems daunting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Between now and end of day Wednesday?
Well,
that's assuming we can get everybody together for a meeting and that you're going to have five people that are going to agree.
I mean, it's none of our business, but I'm sure that they realize they could potentially have the same vacancy issue come January with somebody on council.
They are aware. Yeah. It's
we don't want you to become East Cleveland or Highland Hills, but
I think the difficulties that, you know, yeah, we'd like to
moving
create
that,
some structure.
It, for our purposes, it kind of moves.
Yeah.
We don't like the disharmony, but I mean, it's we'll deal with what we have to do on our side of it. But
there is a deadline, and there isn't anything wrong with elected officials deciding that this is appropriate. It's not like you haven't all talked to people in the last few weeks about
this. Well, there is that, and I do want to remind everyone, and I'm sure we may have to remind our colleagues as well, that this is not a decision that we're making to change the charter. This is a decision that we're making to ask the voters if they'd like to change the charter.
Right.
Good point.
Yeah.
And, you know, that the vote will be the ultimate public comment on whether or not they appreciate or approve of this change.
I mean, and the second part of that is the second paragraph is at the request of the Board of Elections. So we don't, so we can avoid the issue that's going forward now.
Right. Right. Okay, so would you like to provide any other comment?
No, we're satisfied with what's here.
Okay.
As long as we're addressing signature requirements, which, you know, you reference back to that section and the planning deadline. And
so that's the punch list. We've got the signatures.
You have the 90 days for the filing deadline. You have the protest would be encompassed in that. You can't circulate before a certain number of days, which is currently in the charter.
Which will change to one.
Municipal or get rid of that. And then possibly, depending on the appetite of council, extending the 30 to some other I don't think that we should extend the 10 days. I don't think that that's worthwhile. But I do, I guess, other than the mandamus action, there's no other way to force the executive to perform the duty?
I mean, not that I'm aware of it. It becomes a situation somewhat like, you know, not having a, if you don't have the deadline, then you don't have the mandamus option even.
Right.
And so
that creates that.
That's not an easy, straightforward, self-executing option, but it does provide a taxpayer with a remedy,
right,
if they so choose.
Does it say mayor,
give us
or
a second. Give us a second.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, so I think that in this moment, the 10 days is fine, and having anything beyond that is not required. But ultimately, if nobody filed anything, then we would just have to wait until the next appropriate election.
That's right, yeah.
This is the question that I have then. So no matter whether or not the mayor appoints within the 10 days or somebody files to force that, whether or not there's somebody in the seat, there will be an election. And it will be filled at the next general election.
Yes.
Assuming the time frame's correct.
Right.
At the next
right.
general
the next,
election,
the
that
next
is longer than 120.
That's qualifying, yes.
Election.
120. Yeah.
That's a good point. So that could be a long time, but it would happen by virtue of the language and the provision.
Okay. All right. So at this point,
the only thing that we need to reference also back to is you guys have that requirement of only signing one. Which also goes, I mean, if you're just referring back to the
yeah.
section of the charter, it should encompass all that, unless you want to specifically label it here. And we had that conversation, you know, with the first one that's standing we're doing now.
Right.
If you feel it's going to be, you know, just so it's there, then there's absolutely no question as the intent of the council and the voters.
Yeah.
Just import those.
Yeah. And I'm loath to do that because of how ridiculous I think that requirement is, but. I don't know that we can address that in this charter amendment, can we?
Not in this one.
Right.
I mean, you could. I would advise against, I think, taking on another one.
Yeah.
But it does raise the question, if it's specifically laid out here, and it's specifically laid out in section or section 7, Article 7-3. If that were to change, this wouldn't unless you are pointing back.
Are we just by reference?
If we reference it, then you would,
right.
They would interrelate. But if it's not, if we put it specifically here, then you would need to change it in both places if council chose to do that.
Okay, so.
And send it to the voters and change it.
All right, so then the language for petitions could just say, you know, unless otherwise, you know, outlined here, all other requirements from section whatever
right.
will be incorporated.
Signature numbers, limits on, yeah. I'll,
okay.
I mean, so would you have to have the 150 days? Isn't that part of the section 7 too?
I'm sorry, you lost me. No.
You can't get signatures within 150 days?
Yeah.
Isn't that part of 7?
It's 180.
It's 180,
okay.
But yes, but that one is before the mayoral primary date,
oh,
if it's
yeah.
a mayoral election
yeah, yeah.
year. So
yeah.
that one, I think maybe having it here
yeah.
is cleaner. Yes. Now that other, I mean, council could determine to try to change those requirements. You know, they were done for a specific reason to solve a specific problem, but they could probably be cleaned up.
Susanna, any thoughts?
Just the more we make this simplified for our community, the better. This is good direction. And my opinion about 30 days is that given the direction to staff, 30 days, it's doable.
Mm-hmm.
Because we mistakenly put up the application with it. 12 hours off Mary Dunbar, and we were ready to roll.
Which, by the way, I mean, we still could have been taking applications, and council could very easily have made an appointment under these circumstances anyway.
Right.
So it's not like we were in the wrong in doing that.
But I do think giving it the 30 days is absolutely doable.
Okay, now, this is something that I'd like to point out. The charter change that created the elected mayor position also, if I remember correctly, removed some power of council to hire its own staff.
It did.
And that will, in my view, policy, from a policy perspective, will require another charter change later, because I don't think that we have the bandwidth for it right now. But next year, council will not have a staff to put an application out, and they will rely until there's a change made on the benevolence of the mayor to provide that kind of thing, unless by ordinance council mandates that these things happen, which we can, but for next year, you know, we might want to prepare for that and put in place some ordinances making those requirements. But that's something to think about when we make this change. That 30-day issue, you know, well, that's where the automatic thing comes into play if we want to take applications as a general rule.
I don't know. Bill, have you given that some thought because of the change in the charter and taking out council's power? Can we then give ourselves that power back by ordinance?
Within your authority under the charter, you can.
Okay.
There's another provision that has to do with creation of departments that I think was discussed. And, you know, I would say that most of the period of time since January 1 of 2020, aside from COVID, has been spent looking at ways to make sure that the first directly elected mayor can hit the ground running on January 1st of 2022, and making sure that the provisions of the codified ordinances function for that purpose. But there may be a second wave of things that council, the city, may determine would be appropriate to revisit, emanating from issue 26 and just seeing some of these things applied in real life. You know, this is all still a bit of an experiment. We don't yet have a mayor. Council hasn't yet worked with a directly elected mayor. We'll know more about how it all works in a few months.
Yeah. But I think it's appropriate to at least prepare, you know, I mean, for instance, the department creating and dissolving departments, that section, I'm almost done with that draft. So, but it not in time for the November election.
Right.
So it'll be on hold and ready whenever council wants to move on that, if they want to next year.
And that's a bit of an unusual provision at the moment, in my view, but it can be addressed going forward through this process.
Okay.
The charters for May would be early March of 2022, if you're going to go that way?
Yeah,
right.
Unless we change the primary because of redistricting, but we don't know that yet.
Okay.
But 60 days minimum, prior to whatever that date is.
Just so you can keep that in your mind
for
the council to push that through.
And that's why I think it's important maybe to get some of that work done now. Next year, there will be, I think, a benefit and value to the new council to provide them with some things to, you know, look at, instead of having to, I don't know, start it all, you know, whole cloth. So, okay. If we've got nothing more here at the table, I'd like to invite, you know, we can take turns. Lynn, do you want to go first, or Tony, would you like
to? Sure. I'm just going to come up here
so I could be heard a little better, and I can hear Brent a little better. I was having trouble hearing you, Brent. So what I have in front of me is the draft of August 23rd. And I know a lot of specific dates have been thrown out here in time frames and whatever. So I don't have my arms around it 100% yet. But given that caveat, I wanted to first ask a couple of questions of Brent and then proceed generally into my comment, okay? With regard to this current November election and candidates for the open council seat, what we're calling a special election, I think is what it is. So we've gotten approval from you to allow a 56-day rather than a 60-day filing of submission of petitions. I just wanted to know if that's an exception or if that is a rule. How does that play out?
You mean the filing deadline? The council said?
The submission of petitions. The submission of petitions to the Board of Elections is now September 7th rather than the 3rd.
Because of a council action or ordinance given to the Board of Elections.
So that's something that our council has authority to do with the BOE?
Our legal and our director and myself and Corey and Bill have all looked at it, and we all have agreed that under case law and the charter that yes, we can do this.
Okay,
it's never happened before.
Okay.
I mean, the closest we come to is KJ with Shaker Courts, but that was under the revised code.
All right.
And you know, they had 11 days to file petitions, and they reduced the number of signatures required, but that was all spelled out in the revised code ahead of time.
That's good. So the 60 days that that's previously been the case that you some years ago came to the city and said we'd like to move that back to 90 days for submission of petitions. You recall that?
Yes. That's state law.
That is state law, the 90?
Yes.
So then the 6, but it can be overridden by a home rule.
You have Berea at 60 days. Berea was at 90. They went back to 60 because they, whatever reason, which is a really cramps us. I mean, there was discussion amongst all of the city and us about giving your candidates more time to file, but we were actually pushing back our import of the election by a day, and we're going to push, quote, any candidate that files by the deadline is going to get pushed to the ballot department to get them on the ballot. They may come off later because it's easier to take people off than to put them on, but it's really pushing the window for us.
Okay.
Remember, we have a 46-day military ballot due.
So the point is the 90 days is normal procedure.
Yes.
It's normal. Beyond that, it's whatever is agreeable to the Board of Elections and the city, whether it's 60 or 56 or whatever.
You know, state law says 90, not more than 90, but it can be less than 90.
Tony.
You have communities. We had a filing deadline last week. You have South Euclid, Middleburg Heights, and one other, Chagrin Falls Village, that chose 75. Cleveland used to be 75, but as they learned the hard way last time, 4 years ago, they had so much competition, they wanted to be able to protest, and their protest deadline was the next day. It was virtually impossible for them to protest. So they instituted, after years of asking, they went and had a charter amendment, and they pushed it back to the 90 days so they could get the protest deadline.
Okay.
And that's why we're again asking in this, the 90 days, because you want to have the full transparency. You want as much of the revised code in your charter elements to be used in an election as you possibly can.
So that as a consequence, Bill, the 60 days that is on draft 823 has now moved to 90 days?
Correct.
So this particular event that we have before us right now is not going to happen again?
Correct.
If we adopt this charter amendment?
Correct.
It will not happen again. Correct. That's really clarifying for me, so thank you both very, very much. I wanted to make my comment that I am in general agreement with the outlines of this charter amendment, the issue about the mayor, the issue about the 120 days, all those things, I'm generally okay. And if there is ongoing discussion further relating to the actual numbers of days, I'm pretty flexible about that as well. So I know that there are two goals here tonight. One is the fast track of a council vacancy, and I think I'm correct in assuming that that's what we're all about, is fast tracking the council vacancy versus what we had before.
Well, I definitely want to correct the problem. Fast tracking is probably not the way to think about it. It's more along the lines of making sure that we are promptly executing the duties.
With certainty, I think.
Yeah, with certainty. But the second issue is we're also fast tracking this amendment process as well, this particular amendment. And I wanted to just share with you the fact that I'm not in favor of fast tracking this charter amendment. I'm not in favor of notwithstanding your previous discussion about having some special meetings with public comment or maybe doing it electronically. It's pretty fast no matter what, on top of which I don't feel that this rises to the level of emergency legislation either. So I'm just sharing that as a public comment. I don't think that hair is on fire here in Cleveland Heights, but I do know that certain people on council feel that hair is on fire. I can't imagine a repeat of what we had happen in 2020 and early 2021, kind of what you said. Could it happen again? Sure. Would I bet on it? No way. I would not. So I just wanted to leave that issue with you. Lastly,
can I?
Yes, sir.
The second piece of that is, and I'm not talking about council side of it, is the Board of Elections side of it, in trying to administer an election with clearly in our, I'll speak for as the manager for the board, to try to develop an election with charter amendment language that doesn't give us any direction.
You're talking about for the future?
Well, didn't give it, doesn't give it to us. Didn't give it to us now for the as a result of the lady right. resigning. It's not going to give it to us if it happens again in January with a new mayor if a council leaves.
Right.
So I mean, again, I'm going to repeat. This was requested. We went back to our notes. We had the Charter Review Commission the last time. Corey and I asked the commission back then to make it 120 days mm-hmm. and told and suggested this was going to happen. Unfortunately, it did. So again. This is just being brought up to fix the, we're in support of it. We've asked for it 3 years ago, we're asking for it again.
And I'm in support of it.
So it's not necessarily hair on fire, it's trying to correct in our opinion, a faulty piece of the charter that leaves us little room and puts us in a legal bind in how to administer an election.
And a longstanding problem that we've been aware of for quite a while.
Absolutely.
So, and we've discussed quite a bit too.
So let me clarify, the reason for my opposition is not because it won't help the Board of Elections. It clearly will. I'm fully in favor of it, and I'm not suggesting that it be postponed for a year or two or three. There are other opportunities, and I've been presuming that one of the opportunities would be the primary coming up in 2022 to put a charter amendment on that election. It's not a special election. It's a charter amendment. It should be able to go onto the May election, wouldn't you think? So I'm not talking about years here. I'm talking about something where the citizens of Cleveland Heights have an opportunity to absorb what these changes are. It's not like it's super controversial, but I think there's an opportunity to include the public and give the public more time to have input on it. I know that this has been discussed since the spring. It has been. I get that. I'm just feeling, I'm just not real comfortable that this particular thing rises to emergency legislation. My personal opinion. And I don't want to belabor it. Brent, again, for clarity, with regard to the, not exactly so much the charges for the quote-unquote special election. I just want to understand the distinction here between a vacancy on council being filled at a primary election and that this is prevented, that is articulated in law about what can and cannot go on the primary ballot? Is that what my understanding is?
The concern, the reality is, if you were to put a council race on an even year primary, we have a Democratic ballot, we have a Republican ballot, and we have an issues-only ballot. You are a nonpartisan community, and there is virtually no way to have everyone be able to vote on that issue without having your own separate election. So you will in reality have a governor's theory that you're going to have this election in May of 2022, which is a governor's race in all those offices and municipal county judges and all that. So there's three ballots. Your voters are going to go vote on those. We will have a separate election. Your residents will have to go and vote the Democrat Republican issues only ballot. Then they have to go in another line, and they will have to then request a separate ballot for a separate election for filling of the vacancy of council, which is going to be twice as much poll workers.
I get it.
Lots of confusion. I don't know what your facilities are like. If you'd be able to hold
elections, so
you're going to have voters trying to put ballots into the wrong DS-200s because they're assigned to certain elections. You're going to have jams, and it's just and that's what we discussed with Bill. The director was there, the deputy director, and Corey and myself. That is the reality of doing a primary in an even year.
Because that's the way it's articulated in Ohio law, that you cannot include issues on a partisan ballot.
Nonpartisan
issues
combine,
on a partisan.
There's no way to combine the results. You can't have
It's not in other states. So I'm just telling you that. But it's in Ohio.
Our system, issues are separate. Our system does not allow that.
I got it. That was the fundamental question that I had here. And I'm disappointed, by the way. I was hoping that being able to include an issue on a primary ballot was the perfect solution for what we're trying to do, which in my terms, fast tracking the replacement and getting a fast track election as well, perfect solution. I'm disappointed that Ohio law doesn't allow that to happen, but I at least understand what it is. So that was really what I wanted to clarify. My last comment briefly. I think this charter amendment draft of 823, now in 826, I haven't actually had a chance to go through it, but I do. But I wanted to make a general statement about charter language and legislation language. I think this particular example is fairly decent language. I can parse it. I have to study it, but I can parse it, and I have. I want to make a suggestion that for council in future to give some measure of oversight as to not so much the content of the language, which is the normal part of council's role on legislation, but to its language as well. Our language on certain things has not always been pristine, and we can do better.
No, ballot language?
Excuse me?
Talking about ballot language?
No, I am not talking about ballot language. I'm talking about legislation, etc. I don't want to touch ballot language right now. I have a history there. I don't want to go there. Thank you. That was all of the questions I had. And by the way, if at any time offline anybody would like to have a conversation about what the thinking was on some of the issue 26 language as it relates to removing certain things, I don't want to take up time now. I'd be happy to talk.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Tony?
Mr. Gruda, please step up to the table.
All right. So I have two quick questions, and then I'll make a quick comment. Is there a scenario under this language where we pay for a special election?
If it's a general election, you always pay a half of the election. In a general election, in an odd year, you're on the ballot and your school board's on the ballot, see you split that cost down the middle. And if we add other entities to it, like the Port Authority or the Metro Parks, then you start parsing it down even farther. But you're always, in an even, in an odd year, in a general election, you'll pay half the election at the very, at the most.
But in this $112,000, is that, could that happen with
that
this?
Would be in the case of the discussion. Partisan primary question.
Yeah, that was part of the, that was part of the discussion of the primary.
Right. So it could happen with this legislation.
No, because
no, we removed that.
Oh, we removed, okay, that's what I wanted to know.
That's the 826 version, which I don't think you've seen.
Okay, and when we, this is the second question, when we have language like, when we say, well, we don't want to have applicants that have a criminal record, that don't pay their taxes, is that something you ordinarily put in a charter amendment, or do you, do that by ordinance or just by practice?
In my view, it would not be legislated and it would not be charter. I mean, it could be.
I've never seen it in a charter.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
But I think that would be something that most likely would be the individual preference of the people making the appointment.
Okay, so the council body itself.
Everybody has to vote,
right?
And you have your own criteria for that vote. And for the most part, in terms of access to, you know, the way that we make collective decisions, sort of political equity questions, having those things written into either our code of ordinances or our charter really doesn't allow for sort of an expansive view of political equity. So it comes down to the individual preferences and requirements that an individual council member brings to the table. So Craig's ideas of what makes a good council member or, you know, might be different than mine. But the bare minimum legal requirements are that they be a qualified elector in the city of Cleveland Heights.
But our city manager has, by practice, done background checks, correct?
I don't know.
Well, you sent applicants something, since we had to sign something saying that we would allow you to look at our, I forget.
It goes to the chief.
Okay.
But so this is the thing. I think the as I said, that is a preference. There are certain things that we can't, I guess, discuss because of executive session sort of conversation. So I'm going to skip over those things. But as I said, individual council members have preferences for certain things.
Okay.
If I might, Mr. Chairman, I think that's one of the reasons that you would not typically see that language in a charter. You
sure.
Typically wouldn't see it in an ordinance. There's a lot of discretion that's left to council to, and that's one of the reasons that they can discuss these matters in executive session. Ohio law, you know, favors the ability to have sort of unfettered, free discussion about pros, cons, likes, dislikes, so that presumably they arrive at the best possible decision. But in every case that I can think about, the qualifications for a vacancy-filling appointment to council always point back to the general charter requirements for eligibility to serve on council, which is usually being an elector for X number of months or years.
Okay. So I do feel like this is going in the right direction, but it's new. I mean, the Toledo thing was something you talked about very recently. And like Len, I do feel that this is rushed, and it's if there was ever something that should have three readings, I think this is one of them. Again, on the mayor being the kind of like backstop to this whole thing, I still don't like the idea of a mayor being able to throw out of balance the you know, the checks and balances. The mayor's going to put a person in there. I mean, you would just guess that they put a person in there that they thought would be loyal to them, and that could always mess with checks and balances when it comes to you know, how the government functions. I certainly understand how the council person could throw a fly in the ointment. I certainly agree with that. But that at least is a person that council said ought to be there. That council president was elected by, or yeah, I guess elected, are selected by the other council members. So here's the thing. If we don't do this now, and I don't think we should, I do think it should go on the next election. I think that would be the best time to do it. I do feel if there is a possibility, obviously, of having a vacancy January 1st, and I think this should have been done last week when Mary resigned, council should sit down before that application button gets pressed and everything goes out there. That is not the first thing I think we should be doing because of the loose language in our present charter, and there's plenty of it in other areas. I think this charter is not even good for a city manager form of government, let alone an elected mayor form of government. And it needs a lot of work. I think most people would agree with that. But given what we have now, there's a very easy remedy. Council sits down, they set some rules in public. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to make a decision in 45 days. If we don't make a decision, here's the contingency plan, and this is the process we're going to use. And they agree to it in public, and then they stick to it. Now, I understand that's not a charter amendment, but if that happens January 1st and we don't have an amendment, that's what I would strongly suggest the process be. Then the applications go out, not the other way around. Process, public, applications. So that's something we could do. I think 45 days is better than 30 days for the written reasons I think I've sent the two of you, because, you know, 2 weeks you get the applications. Then sometimes you have to extend things. We've done that before. Maybe we don't do that. But if we want to do the video thing and so forth and then talk about it, that does take time. I think 45 days is better than 30. And I think I'll just leave it there. And I really appreciate the opportunity to speak.
Thank you.
Sure.
If I could just ask one question. So if we don't put this on the ballot in November, and assuming we were to have a vacancy January 2nd, that person that would get appointed would then serve the 2 years. Is that correct? Because that appointment would be under the current charter provision, and they would serve the rest of that expired term.
I don't know what seat the vacancy would be in.
The current, well, it would only be one of two based on the scenario that you're probably imagining.
Right.
But it could be a different scenario. You could elect someone and then they could resign.
Resign.
But I think that in this case, it's under our current vacancy section, it would be more than 60 days. So they would make an appointment, and the appointment would be good through December 31.
31st.
And then at that election,
okay,
in November, the replacement to continue the rest of the unexpired term would take place.
All right.
Yes, no?
Under our existing.
No, it would go
under our existing language, it would go out to December 31 following the next regular municipal
election. The next regular municipal, yeah. So this would, yeah. So it would be the end of it, yeah.
So they will serve two. They, in theory, would serve 2 years if we don't pass something.
Right.
Okay.
This year's an odd year, so if it had happened this year, it would
right.
So right now we have a specific, you know, municipal election, which is defined as odd year. So, yeah, I think that's a problem, but I don't know that anyone else does. I prefer that the vacancy be filled by appointment for as little time as possible, generally.
And in order to accomplish that, we need to put that provision on the ballot for November. Or at least give the voters an opportunity to vote on it.
Answer this question if you can. And I don't know if we have an answer.
Brent?
My question is this. If next year's council, if this council fails to create a fix for this problem, and next year's council decides that it's going to take this up and it makes a change, perhaps after someone's appointed, can they make a change that will shorten that person's term to the end of next year as opposed to the end of?
So I don't think so.
I didn't either.
I would double check it before I answered with certainty, but based on other situations with changes of that nature, I think that would be a retroactive change in office to which they're otherwise appointed and qualified.
Right. So yeah, we can fix it now, or the next likely opportunity will not be a fix for that particular opportunity. So. But I also want to point out, I understand that this is a particular set of ideas, you know, in a particular language that we're looking at now. But we've been talking about the amount of time that council has to fill a vacancy, what the remedy is if council fails to do so, and then whether or not this is something that goes to an election, in which election for a very long time. We've been discussing these things in public view. This particular language is a particular combination of those things that we've been talking about for quite a while. So 30 days versus 45 days. I suppose we could have two readings according to our you know, regular order, two readings at council meetings to discuss whether it's 30 days or 45 days, let's say, hypothetically, to provide opportunity for public comment and for the public to take a look at this issue. Two readings to discuss whether it should be the mayor or council president or, I don't know, random person on the street, if we wanted to, and provide opportunity for public comment on that. Two readings for, I suppose, the language that the Board of Elections would prefer, given the timelines and petition signing deadlines. But in terms of discussing the actual substantive issues, we've been discussing this since the Charter Review Commission. And so I'm not sure. I have some concern about dumping this on the next council for them to take up, especially since we should have solved this problem a long time ago. I don't know that waiting makes it better. But that's just my, I guess, not even fully formed opinion at this point. I don't know if you have any thoughts on this or anything else before we move on.
No, I think I agree with you that we need to get it on the ballot. I mean, certainly we've discussed it enough. And if it is our desire to give the voters an opportunity to address the next time there's a vacancy, this is our chance.
One thing I do
rather than kick it to next year, and you're going to have a completely different city council, regardless of what happens.
Yeah. And we may, honestly, based on the makeup of them, we've got six members right now. We may not get five on this, so we'll have to see. And it may not pass. That's the other issue. And so it's possible that based on those two questions, even if we, you know, try to move this forward, the next council may have to deal with this problem as well, based on those things. There was something else that we wanted to discuss?
There was, with regard to this subject or another piece of legislation?
Well, if you had more on this subject.
No, I don't. I just wanted to be clear.
It's about allowing boards and commissions during COVID.
Correct.
To do virtual WebEx.
I got it. Okay. Do you mind if we take a brief break? I'm going to run to the right back.
Sure. Take care.
Okay, so the question about boards and commissions having the ability We have the authority to allow them to do that, but we do not have the authority to allow ourselves to.
Yeah, the trick is, do we know, are we on, are we ready to go?
He said give him 5 seconds.
Okay. So, right, the under the city's home rule authority, we should have the authority to provide for virtual meetings unless the charter prohibits it or provides differently. And otherwise, it authorizes exercise of all home rule authority by ordinance, if not in the charter. The council meeting provision references council meeting at such times and at such public places within the city as may be prescribed by ordinance or resolution.
Mm-hmm.
There is a possible construction of public places within the city that, you know, might be the airwaves. You know, there's some support for that in federal law, et cetera. I'm not sure that that's a completely convincing argument. And for council's decisions in meetings to be upheld, you know, you want to be sort of rock solid about that.
Mm-hmm.
In the codified ordinances, it provides that, and the codified ordinance refers to, and it's 10701B, refers to both council and other public bodies of the city. It provides that unless otherwise provided in the codified ordinances, meetings of council, boards, commissions, other public bodies are held at city hall or other public buildings or properties within the city. So it is possible for other public bodies of the city who are not referenced in the charter with a specific meeting place to, we believe, provide for virtual meetings with a codified ordinance provision building on the unless otherwise provided in the codified ordinances mm-hmm. language. And so this the ordinance that we've drafted, and this is not something that has to be passed by next Friday. This is not, you know, bound by the same deadlines as a charter amendment would be.
Right.
Would provide for essentially the same standards that were enacted by the state legislature in 2020 for public bodies to meet virtually to apply, but would provide specifically that public bodies of the city other than council could meet in that fashion. At the moment, it's got a blank sunset date.
Mm-hmm.
That's not required. You know, this is an evolving area, and I think Brent just mentioned that, you know, there are some communities that are sending charter amendments through now to make that possible for all of their public bodies. That question is not fully decided by the courts either. I mean, this is a new issue, but there's lots of good arguments why you could do that by charter as a home rule community.
So, all the good reasons to do virtual meetings. There's a convenience aspect to it. It's possible, I guess, that you create more participation.
Yes.
But let's think about what the downsides are. Does anybody know of any?
Somebody doesn't have a computer.
Okay.
Right.
That's the only thing I can think of.
Well,
I mean, this came to me because TAC, Commission on Aging, Parks and Rec, planning, concerns about COVID with their children, family members not wanting to be in a room, and saying, why can't we can get the business done by going back to WebEx.
Mm-hmm.
And on the other side of it, in addition, is we're not gonna have a quorum at some of these. That's why Parks and Rec isn't meeting this month. So it's sort of a responsibility on our part to allow the boards and commissions to continue. I mean, I agree there should be some kind of a caveat that this is in place because of a health crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Or it could be an emergency or exigent circumstance declared by, you know, blank city manager or mayor or
right.
council president, something like that, or council.
You know, and theoretically, going forward, you could provide for that ability in cases of severe weather. That doesn't happen a lot, but sometimes in the winter, you have to get bugs. You have to cancel a meeting, and this would potentially obviate that need to cancel. Downsides, I think it's more difficult to provide for public comment and public participation. That's something that, you know, Cleveland Heights heard and other communities have heard. It may be possible, but it's probably a lot more difficult to do that. Other than that, I'm not sure what all the downsides might be.
Yeah, I think that's a major downside. So if we're going to do this, we need to have some technology that does allow the public to comment in real time, as opposed to sending email questions or chat questions. And I don't know that it currently that we're getting, you know, that many people attending that we couldn't accommodate the public. So are we exclusively using WebEx, or are we using a combination of WebEx and Zoom for our meetings?
We use WebEx at the direction of the IT department.
Okay.
Because it has something to do with you can't be hacked as easily. It's sort of a government thing.
And so there is a way that a moderator can let people in to make public comment.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking about Commission on Aging. I'm thinking about some of these boards where they're not functioning with public comment.
Okay.
Like Commission on Aging, even Parks and Rec, TAC. Like Planning Commission, BZA, is always open, and staff knows how to, and staff did that when it all was virtual, to allow for public comment and presentation by people coming in front of the board. You know, depends on the function.
Is it? I mean, so both for council and for other public bodies of the city, public places, public properties within the city are potential appropriate meeting places without any change. Are there spaces elsewhere that would allow more social distancing that would otherwise accommodate? I mean, it gets tight in council chambers at times, particularly for people who are attending.
But, you know, Parks and Rec Board and Commission on Aging, they meet at the community center.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they're nervous about it. The community center is basically closed, except for little, at the request of residents who are concerned.
Right. I mean, but we control that space.
We control it,
if the city needed to do that, if the council doesn't do something.
I'm concerned about our Monday meetings in here. We're going to have a lot of people coming. I'm going to have staff out in the hall limiting how many can come in.
One of the ways that we deal with overflow at the county level with the county council is by providing for overflow rooms mm-hmm. that have access to a screen so that they can see what's going on.
Which we can do down in the atrium. Steve has it set up that what he's filming can show down there.
Okay.
So, but even then, you need social
distancing.
Distancing. It's a real issue.
Now, if we do decide that this is a good idea to move forward with, I think obviously Craig makes a good point about the public comment, making sure that in those boards where public comment is utilized, that it be allowed in sort of a real-time kind of way. And I think that that's possible and has been done. We're adept enough at this point, I think, to elevate people to a panelist and then remove them back, you know, to the participant or an attendee, I think.
Yeah, because I'm sure, like with BZA, when you invite neighbors or ABR, that when we were in complete lockdown with COVID, that we had that element, staff put that element in place.
Mm-hmm.
So that is something that's very doable.
The other thing that I think we should think about is if we're doing this, it makes it much easier to provide a video record of these meetings.
That's true.
Which I think is something that we can and should do, pandemic or not.
Yeah, that's true.
Because the technology is there. It's easy. And so, you know, moving away from, say, the audio recording archived from Planning Commission, instead just moving to the video recording and archiving that publicly accessible. I think the way that technology has progressed, it's as easy to do that as anything else at this point. So from an expediency standpoint, it doesn't really tip the scale.
I mean, it would be ideal if the state legislature had either extended what they already had or made some other provision, but to date, they've not done that.
And the numbers are going up pretty
right.
close to where they were before when we were in a crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Really bad.
So
I don't blame our residents for being concerned about coming to the board or commission meeting.
That, yeah.
So are we thinking of this just in terms of that concern, or are we thinking this in an ongoing, this should change the way that we do things point forward?
I was thinking of it in terms of the health crisis.
Okay.
That's where I'm coming from. Because those are the inquiries I got. And in fact, when I walked out of here Wednesday night and TAC was in the atrium,
mm-hmm.
and Sam Bell and Laura Marks, they both said, why can't we be virtual? Why are we here? This is scary, you know. And to me, it's health, but it could be extended, I suppose.
Yeah.
So we tried to, or we kicked around the notion of putting together a charter amendment for this purpose. But given the events of the last couple of weeks, it did seem like maybe that was one hill too many to climb. And so this is a partial step in that direction. Again, council could put it on a committee of the whole committee agenda for some discussion, and then, you know, we could do some additional research and make sure this is pulled together to accomplish the objectives with regard to public comment that we've heard tonight. You know, it could be ready relatively quickly, but we appreciate your putting it on the agenda for some committee discussion.
I would like to, you know, moving forward, I do want to go back to the, like, this is an opportunity, I think, to provide for public comment at these meetings, and it can be structured. You know, we can time limit it. We can, you know, the sort of thing if we want to. But also, I think the video recording
I like
should
that.
Be a requirement.
Yeah, I think that's good.
So,
well, thank you for listening to this.
Any other?
No.
Okay.
So we'll on this piece, we'll plan to sort of further polish it and have it ready for future council discussion and action.
Thank you.
And on the charter amendment piece, we'll make a couple of changes that we discussed tonight with respect to the actual language, and that would be on your agenda for Monday's special.
And you'll get that right away to Steve.
Yes.
So he can post it and doesn't have to worry about it.
Right.
And then they're putting the packets together, so. So therefore, we are not putting virtual
right.
on the agenda.
Right.
You can wait.
Okay, I'll have the boards and commission members call you both.
Absolutely. Okay, well, I guess with that, if there's nothing Council's attention. We are adjourned.
Thank you.